In this module, we'll be learning about Windows Workflow Foundation and Windows Communication Foundation interceptors for business activity monitoring. In the first lesson, we'll focus on the BAM interceptor architecture, the fundamental model that allows for additional interceptors to collect information and to submit it into the BAM databases. In lesson two, we'll focus specifically on the interceptor for Windows Workflow Foundation, the types of data you can collect and how you wire that up. And finally, in lesson three, we'll look at the WCF interceptor, again, the types of information you can collect and how you wire that interceptor into your WCF service. As we begin lesson one, we'll focus on that interceptor architecture for business activity monitoring. Today, there's two additional interceptors that are provided, one for Windows Workflow Foundation and one for Windows Communication Foundation. But the model is built such that it could be extended and additional interceptors can be added. Those interceptors are integrated into the BAM infrastructure, and we'll see how to do that. We'll see how to configure the interceptors to identify what's to be collected and to also set up the common infrastructure within BAM. And so we'll see how to build that configuration and deploy it, and I'll show you a demonstration of how to apply an interceptor configuration. Now, BizTalk provides those two .NET providers or interceptors, as I mentioned, for business activity monitoring. And these are based on .NET 3.5. So while there is a Windows Workflow Foundation 4, the model is different, the code is different for that, the APIs, and so this interceptor will work with existing Windows Workflow Foundation 3 or 3.5 workflows. It'll work then also with Windows Communication Foundation services. Neither of these requires you to write any code, and that was really the goal, is that you should be able to configure for both of these runtimes, WCF and WF, configure what it is you want collected and when and how that relates to your BAM model and the different checkpoints that are part of your activity. So you'll configure the interceptor, add it into the appropriate runtime environment, and allows you then to track information, not just in your BizTalk components, but also in your services and in your workflows. You can see an example here of what this enables, which is the collection of data from a variety of different components that are all related to the same business process, but aren't all BizTalk artifacts. So we have some data collected from a WCF service that might be the first point where data is received, and we want to use that as the start time of the process. We could collect additional data from BizTalk in the form of port mappings or orchestration mappings using the tracking profile editor. And we can also collect data from Windows Workflow, where we might have workflows that are called or invoked from our orchestrations or through some sort of messaging, maybe through a service call to a workflow service. We'll be able to take all that data and pull it together into the same BAM activity so that we can get a true end-to-end view of what's happening in the system, even though it's not all happening in BizTalk. The interceptor configuration that you'll build is XML files. The SDK for a BizTalk server comes with schema for those interceptors. And there's a common set of configuration that you'd apply across interceptors, but there's also specific technology interceptors like the workflow and WCF interceptors that extend that schema with their own elements. Now, the tracking profile editor is focused on interceptors that are built into BizTalk for orchestration and for messaging, and so it doesn't support editing interceptors for workflow and WCF. So we'll use a text editor or use the editing capabilities of Visual Studio to do that. And one of the benefits of using Visual Studio is that if we copy the schemas to the XML schemas folder for Visual Studio, we can get XML IntelliSense and we'll know the appropriate elements that are available in a particular scope. This gives you a high-level idea of things that are in the interceptor configuration file or this tree of definition. We're going to start in the interceptor configuration by identifying the BAM activity that we're working on. And then we have this notion of events. And so events can have filters that you apply to indicate whether or not the data should be collected. They have the ability to do updates, which is where you specify that you want to write some data to BAM. And we also have the notion of correlation, so we can enable this end-to-end processing through correlation IDs and tokens, and the ability to add references to other activities or other items. All of these things, if you're familiar with BAM, should sound fairly familiar. The filter is kind of unique in that we're using that to identify whether we should take some actions. But correlation or continuation, as it's called in the BAM APIs, the updates, the references, those all map fairly directly onto the BAM programming model. When you begin creating that interceptor configuration, you need to add a couple of things to it. One is the event source. The event source really indicates your workflow or your particular service that you're hosting. It calls out the technology type, so today, WF or WCF, and it calls out then that specific implementation. So this helps identify that source that data is going to be coming from, so that at runtime, when your workflow is sending information or your WCF service is sending information, it can be mapped onto this configuration and we can find out what elements should be getting tracked. So you can see an example here, the interceptor configuration, the namespace called out. You can also see an example with the XMLNS:BAMWF of calling out an interceptor specific configuration where we have the namespace now for the workflow pieces. And you can see the event sources identified there by their type names, so their fully qualified type name with the assembly name, the specific technology, and then we provide a name, which is what we use throughout the rest of the configuration to refer back to this particular event source. We have the event sources, and now we'll identify the BAM activity. So the BAM activity is going to be the overall item that represents the data to be extracted for your particular BAM activity. Now, you're only going to have one per unique name, so you can identify multiple activities in the same configuration file, but you can only have one BAM activity here, obviously, with the same name. The onEvent element is going to identify that when a particular event happens, this is the wrapper or the connection then to what actions do we want to take? What do we want to do with regards to collecting BAM information? Now, obviously, the interceptor config will have many different events in many scenarios. It could just have one, but in most cases, it will have more than one. It will provide a particular name that's just unique here for within our application, but we'll also refer back to that event source. So we now have a link between the event source, that workflow or service, and particular events. So as we get into the runtime, we're able to look up based on a given event source, what are all the events we should be watching for. There's also flags here for the events that dictate whether or not this is a special case in that it is either the begin event for an activity or the end event. And these really map directly onto the BAM API to indicate whether to begin or end the activity. One of the things you'll see pretty predominantly in these configuration files is the notion of expressions. So when you get into the onEvent, all the different child nodes in there are going to have certain expressions that'll be evaluated. They might be conditions, they might be things that produce data or write elements, but they're going to be listed now underneath those child elements. And inside those expressions, we have different operations. So you can really think of these as code expressions almost. We're going to have a set of expressions that are tied together by these operations. Now, an operation provides some particular value and puts it onto the internal stack for evaluation. Some things, like the operations on the right, are more static, and so they identify the and you want to concatenate things together, or you want to use a constant value. Others are linked to methods that are called by the interceptor. So they might be to extract data from a workflow, or to pull data out of a WCF message, or to grab the particular timestamp when something happens. One of the things that usually takes people a little while to understand is the notation used in these interceptor configuration files, because it uses a reverse Polish notation. And this is a notation where the operations tend to follow the parameters, essentially, that go to that. So you can see an example down below with the infix notation that you might be used to, and the reverse Polish notation on the right-hand side. Now, because this is XML, it kind of reduces the need for us to group things together a certain way or pass things into constructs that are harder to represent in XML. As an example, you could see here that we have an expression. We've got several different operations. The first one is using that constant operation and providing it an argument. So we're just defining a constant of value underscore. Then we have another operation using that constant again, providing in the argument underscore other value. And you'll notice that following that is an operation called concatenate. So we've identified the two arguments, value and other value, and now we supply the concatenate, which will operate on those previous two elements. Then we add the operation of constant with and other, and another operation of concatenate. So there the concatenate will operate on the and other, and the previous result of the concatenate, so that we get the results shown at the bottom. Now, when you configure your interceptor, your configuration, you're really going to have this, it's going to go in and determine whether or not a particular event is a match. And so the filter allows you to specify some conditions that resolve to true or false, that are going to identify whether or not you actually want to act on the event at this time. So the event itself, maybe that a workflow started or an activity executed or an operation was invoked on the service, but you may only want to track that information under certain conditions, and the filter allows you to do that. Correlation ID is one piece of the continuation. So within the on event, after you've applied your filter, you can specify a correlation ID, and this is what's going to be passed in as the activity ID. It's especially important if you're doing continuation that you have the right ID, but if you're using an on-start event, or you say that a particular event is the start, then that correlation ID will become the activity ID. So this is really just your continuation here, where you're following a continuation, you're providing the ID you want to use to write to that ID, or sorry, write to that activity. Another key piece is the update. This is where we're actually going to write some data into the BAM tables. And so we provide both the type name and the data item name. And this is going to refer back to whatever your checkpoint name was in your activity definition. So just like the API, we can do multiple updates at one point within this construct. So if an event happens, you don't have to just update one value. It might be that that event represents both a date time timestamp as well as some values of text or numeric types. The reference allows you to evaluate and add a reference to another activity. And so we'll then need to specify, obviously, through the arguments, what that information is. The correlation token is where we enable continuation. So here is where you would specify a particular value that you want to write out to enable continuation. So you might have generated an ID in a web service call, and you want to enable continuation into the orchestration or into a workflow or another service. This is the equivalent of the enable continuation, and you use parameters then to specify the new token. Once you've gone through and created the interceptor configuration with the on events, with their filters, when you specified all the updates that you want and the continuations and references, then you need to actually deploy the interceptor configuration. And when these items were introduced in a previous version of BizTalk, the BAM model and the tool, the BAM management tool, was updated to take commands for working with these interceptors. So we have the notion of deploying an interceptor, removing it, getting a list, or getting a particular interceptor where we could go in and provide a particular filter. So this is the model, just like we can with a activity definition, deploy out the activity definition, we can deploy our interceptors using that same command line tool. In this demonstration, I'm going to show you how to set up your Visual Studio environment to get the XSD or XML schema type definition in IntelliSense. We'll take a look at the interceptor configuration file so you can see some examples of those commands in the setup. And then we'll deploy that interceptor configuration file as well as a orchestration tracking profile. In this example, we're going to learn about the interceptor configuration files. Now in this solution, I've got a couple of interceptor configurations here. One is empty and one has some setup. So you can see I have this root element here, interceptor configuration, and I have my root XML namespace, as well as a couple of aliased namespaces here for the workflow and WCF components. Now if I come in here and begin typing and try and get IntelliSense, you'll notice that I really don't get much help. I can comment or put CData, not much use there. What I really want is to have that IntelliSense from the schemas. So let me go out to Program Files here. We'll go into BizTalk Server 2010. We're going to go into the SDK and the samples. As we get in here under the BAM samples, we have the interceptor XSDs. So we'll copy those. We'll come back up here to Visual Studio 2010. Go into XML schemas, and we'll just paste those in there. We've got all those schemas in there now. Now you can already see we're starting to get a little IntelliSense where we're getting some warnings. So now we can see that we can specify an event source with a name and a technology. For the name, we'll call this one Billing WF. For the technology, we can plug in WF there. And the manifest for right now, I'll just leave blank. That's where we'd put the name of the assembly. So we can add another one in here, for example, that would be the name of client proxy. And this is just the name that we're using. WCF, and we'll leave the manifest blank there again. So you can see that by adding that the schemas in, we now get all of our definitions. I can see now that I can add event sources, or I can begin typing and adding in additional information for my BAM activity, and I further get IntelliSense as I go down inside of that file. Now let's close that out. We'll take a look at a file that's already been completed. So we can see the event sources there. Same thing, Billing WF. Now here we've got that fully qualified assembly name. You can see why I didn't want to try and type that and get it right. So we have the billing workflows billing process. That's our class in this assembly. And we have in the order service, in the order client assembly, we have the client proxy manifest. Now here we've got some namespace mappings, and we've got to map NS0 as a prefix onto a particular namespace. Then we see the BAM activity. So the BAM activity is going to map to our BAM definition, our activity definition that we've created. And we're going to see this collection of on events. You can see I can collapse those. Those are kind of our next top level events. And this one we've given a name of billing activity. And we've then referenced back to the event source. And so well, this source for this particular event is going to be that workflow, that billing WF. And we're going to use that name we gave it to identify it. And we're also going to call out that this is going to be the end and potentially the beginning of our billing activity. Within that, we're going to see the filter, and we're going to be able to get in then and notice that we have this get activity name, process billing, and we have an equals operation here. So we're looking for an activity called process billing, and we're also looking for the activity event of closed. So that's our filter. Our filter says when that activity called process billing closes, then this event is a match. And then we've added in here the correlation ID. So we're going to use orchestration or orc underscore here. And we're also going to get the workflow property, which is the order ID. So this is an argument or a property on the workflow, something that's going to get passed into the workflow. And we're going to concatenate then order ID with this orc underscore. That's going to give us our continuation token. And we can see here then that we're going to do an update. So we've got our events, we have our filters and some correlation, and we have some updates in here. Let's take this now. We want to go and deploy this. So we're going to go in here and we'll go to the BizTalk install path. In the tracking folder. And from in here, we can run our BAM management tool. Whoops, I'm going to type it correctly. And you'll see that we get a list of all the different commands that it supports. And you'll notice that in there, the last set, deploy interceptor, get interceptor list, and remove interceptor, have been added to support these new interceptor models that we can use. And if we want to find out the parameters for those things, we can do BAM, or the business activity monitoring tool here, and we can specify that we want help. And the command we want help with is deploy interceptor. And it tells us then that it's going to deploy the BAM interceptor to the BAM primary import database. It tells us we have parameter called file name. Then we have some optional parameters of ForeSQL true to override, or we can provide optional overrides for the server and the database. So let's try that. So we'll do BAM management, deploy interceptor, file name. We're going to give that the file name. So we'll do Dynamo code module 17. Interceptor configuration.xml. And because I got that back, I know that I must have typed something wrong here. I've got too many. Oh, I forgot the dash before my parameter here on file name, so we'll put that in. Now it's going to go out and deploy my interceptor. All that configuration that we had in there is now deployed. Now I can also go in and I can deploy a tracking profile. I'm going to pull this up. This should look familiar. This is just going to be a standard BAM tracking profile here that you can see. So we've got common things being pulled out of different places. So we can see these things coming out of orchestrations here. And we also have all these continuations. So we've got one here where we've got a continuation and a continuation ID. We also have these continuations here. One, we're going to enable continuation with orc underscore order number. Well, we saw in our file, our interceptor configuration, that later we're going to follow that particular continuation. And here we have the WCF underscore order number. This is one that's going to be generated for us at the WCF level, and we're going to follow it in the orchestration. Let me go ahead and apply that tracking profile as well. I am going to get a warning saying, hey, you have this continuation ID, WCF underscore, but you don't have a matching continuation. In this case, that's okay because I know that continuation is going to be enabled from elsewhere. So now I've deployed a regular tracking profile and my interceptor config. Both of those things now are going to be linked together by those continuations and enable me to collect data across those technologies. In our second lesson, we're going to focus on the Windows Workflow Interceptor. So you'll get a chance to see the specific configuration setup for the Workflow Interceptor. We'll see how to deploy one, and we'll also look through a demonstration of applying those techniques. Windows Workflow already has in it a tracking service, much like the BAM infrastructure built into orchestrations in BizTalk. And so we take the interceptor configuration that's created and it's converted on the fly into a workflow tracking profile. Again, much like the tracking profiles we build in the tracking profile editor, but something that Windows Workflow understands as opposed to the BizTalk orchestration engine. Now, Windows Workflow can support multiple tracking services at the same time, and so we can use this BAM interceptor alongside the SQL tracking service or custom tracking services that we might also have added into the workflow runtime. The interceptor itself provides a number of operations, and these are all going to be found in that workflow-specific schema and schema namespace. And you'll see here from the chart, when we go out and get particular operations, you can see where that information comes from in the workflow tracking system. So we can get an activity event, and that's going to go out and get the particular status. We could get an activity's name, or we can go and get particular properties off an activity so that we can extract a value from one particular step. Activity types, we can get context values, several different items around the user data, so custom code that has called into the tracking API. And we can also get events around the workflow and workflow level properties or arguments going in or out of the workflow. The getContext property really gives us two key properties that are available with the WF interceptor, the event time and the instance ID. Now, that instance ID, much like an orchestration ID, is going to be unique for every workflow instance. So it provides a unique identifier for us that we might need to use for things like continuation, or that we might want to use as the activity ID in certain scenarios. All the other operations in there map onto particular pieces of the tracking infrastructure of workflow, particular tracking points or tracking records. In Windows Workflow, there are three of those different kinds of track points. There's a workflow track point where you get events about workflows being created or started, the activity track point, which can happen as the steps in the workflow move from different states, executing to closed, and you have the ability to extract information at those points. And then the user track point maps back onto that custom code where somebody's written some code in their workflow to call out to the tracking API. So if we look at a simple example here of a filter, you can see we're applying a filter in an event. And we've said that the workflow operation name, we're using the getWorkflow event. And you can see we're also using an operation constant here to say started. So our filter is indicating that we're interested in an operation, we're interested in the getWorkflow event when it's started. So we want to have some BAM updates or references or other steps take place only when the workflow moves into that started state. And so this is how we can compose together some of those workflow operations in our filters or our expressions to identify those different steps. As we get a little bit more complex, you can see here in our filter that we've identified a particular activity type equal to that constant. We've also got the activity property there where we want to get the name, and we want to have that mapped to the constant trackable amount. So you can see we're doing an equals on that. And then we also want the get activity event of closed. So as you pull all these together with these different operations, you can see that we're saying we're looking for a particular activity type with a given a particular activity with a type and name. So it's called trackable amount and it is a my activity. And we want to track that, or we want to filter on when that gets closed, when that completes. And that then allows us to use this filter. We know when that particular activity instance has closed, and then we could go out and pull information out to do updates or correlation. The instance ID, as I mentioned, is a unique ID and trackable. So that's a pretty common thing to use as you're correlating at least within the workflow instance. But you could also use other IDs or activity information if it made sense. Here are a couple of examples of once we've applied those filters and we get the activity instance we want at the state we want, we can then use the update, map that type information and data item name to our BAM activity. Then we can use the getActivity property, for example, and indicate that through the argument that we want to pull a particular activity property, the amount, for example. Or we want to pull out the getContext property and get that event time to log the time that a particular activity event happened. There's a BizTalk side of things, of course, where we'll need to deploy the interceptor, but we also need to configure the workflow environment to use that interceptor to install it as a tracking service. So we need to create that. It's provided as part of the SDK as a class. We need to construct that and add it into the workflow runtime and provide it two pieces of information, the connection string to our appropriate BAM database, and a timer value to indicate how often it should check for changes to the interceptor configuration. So that service then will start up, we'll load up the interceptor configuration from the BAM database, and we'll then apply that as a tracking profile and begin to track those changes and make those updates. And based on our timer that we provided, it'll also go back and see if there have been any changes to the interceptor configuration so that it can keep fresh and keep current on the items it's supposed to be tracking. You can see here we've created the workflow runtime. We create an instance of the BAM tracking service with the timer value and the connection string to the BAM primary import. And we simply add that service into the runtime. Now, Windows Workflow also allows you to do a configuration-based adding of services. And so there's an example here of that as well, where you can see the BAM tracking service with its connection string and its interceptor configuration polling interval attributes set. In this demonstration, we'll take a look at how to use those WF interceptor configuration. So you'll see some real examples of the interceptor configuration file. We'll see how to initialize the BAM tracking service within the runtime, and we'll test out the interceptor configuration and make sure that data is getting written to the BAM store. This demonstration will look specifically at the Windows Workflow interceptor. I'm going to start by opening up this workflow called billing process. You can see that it's a pretty simple workflow. It has one activity in here called process billing. And if I look to that activity, I'll see that it has a property called order total amount. That's the amount that I'm going to want to track into my BAM database. So I'm going to want to be able to collect that from this activity when it's done executing and be able to store that out in the BAM database. Now, if we look at the code behind, you'll see that I also have properties on here for the order ID. So the order ID on the workflow is going to be a parameter that gets passed in here to the workflow as it begins executing. So we've got the property, the order ID that we're worried about, and we're also worried about that order amount that we're going to get from the activity. Now, if we look at the interceptor configuration that we have, we can see up at the top here that we've identified our event source called billing.bav, and we've pointed that to that billing process workflow then. We've said that's our manifest. It's going to be that workflow. So this mapping then is going to enable when we set up the runtime and the interceptor, it's going to see that and say, I found my event source. I'm the workflow. I am running this particular workflow. I can find by the manifest and the technology type my event source. And now I know that I have this name called billing.bav. And that then enables it to go through and find any of these on event elements down here that have that source. So as we set up the workflow runtime, it's going to be able to look through this manifest or look through this interceptor config and find all the events that it should be concerned about by finding those that matching event source and then finding the matching elements. Now inside there, of course, we have our filter so that even though we have that particular event source, we want to specify only particular events. So we can get our operation name here called getActivityName, and that's going to be the process billing, that one single activity that we had in there. And with our reverse Polish notation, then we see that it applies an equals to those two things. Then it'll also do getActivityEvent and a constant of closed equals those together with reverse Polish notation, then an and those two together. So the filter, even though we have this source, is did an event happen that involved this activity going to the closed state? And if so, then we continue processing and identify the key pieces of data that we're going to collect, as well as the correlation. So here we're indicating a correlation ID, which means we're going to be following some correlation or continuation in BAM terms. And so we have a constant here of orc underscore, and we have this get workflow property operation passing in an argument of order ID. So go to the workflow itself, we know that's our billing workflow, and find the order ID property on there and concatenate that with our reverse Polish notation, concatenate that order ID with this constant of orc underscore. That's your continuation token. That's what this code or the runtime code that interprets this is going to use to write data into the BAM event streams. And it's going to say, I'm writing to this continuation token. So of course we have to have enabled that continuation with that ID prior to this code executing. And then finally we have the key piece that we want, which is the update, where we're going to go and update some particular data item. In this case, it's going to be a float, and it's going to be called order total. And that order total is going to map to and a checkpoint within our BAM activity definition. And we're going to get that value by getting an activity property, and it's going to be the order total amount. Now notice that this is only going to fire based on our filter when that particular activity, process billing, goes to the closed state. So we know when we come and say get activity property that the activity this is going to act on, or the activity it's going to be going out and querying against, is that activity, and it's going to be able to find the order total amount property on there. So we have our interceptor configuration. We've deployed that early on. We have the activity here and our properties. But the one thing we have yet to do is to hook all this stuff together. So let's go look at our billing application. This is a kind of a poor excuse for a billing system, but it's the Billing Machine 5000. And what it's going to do is go out and monitor a particular folder. And when files arrive, it's going to pop those files in and read those. So as the event fires that a particular file was created, it's going to go in and use an X element in the system.xml.link namespace to load up that document and then go in and pull out the order ID and the total value that were shipped over in there. It's going to put those in this order number and order total variables. Now we create a workflow runtime. This is the key class in workflow 3 and 3.5 that is going to host and run our workflows. And we're going to then add to that a service. And this particular service is the BAM tracking service. Now that BAM tracking service is coming from a referenced assembly. If we go look here, we'll see we've added a reference to the Microsoft BizTalk BAM interceptors assembly. You're going to find that in the tracking directory of the BizTalk install path, along with all the BAM management tools and other things related to BAM. And so we've added that in and added the using statement up top. And now we have that BAM tracking service, and we've given it a connection string to the BAM primary import so that it can go load that interceptor configuration at runtime, and also an interval at which it should go and pull the database for any changes to the interceptor configuration. So as long as this host is up and running, if we go change the interceptor configuration, it'll pull those up periodically and apply those at runtime. Finally, we're going to go create the workflow. And when we do that, we're going to pass in some arguments. And the arguments we're going to pass in then are the order ID and an order amount that goes in there. Once we've done that, we'll initiate the workflow, start all of the processing there to get that working and running and processing over that file information that we found. So let's test this out. So I want to start my billing application. So we're ready to go. Let's submit an order now. I'm going to pick up that internal order, submit it over to BizTalk. Okay, our order's been submitted to BizTalk now, so it's gone into BizTalk server. You can see the workflow completed there and finished. So let's submit an acknowledgement back just to finish up our process. And now we should have completed our overall process with BAM. Let's fire up our Report Viewer application. This is just a client application that's also in the solution and uses SQL Server reporting services to go and build a view over the BAM views. So we can see now our order progress, the order's complete. We've got information about when billing was submitted, when the order was received, the order total, shipping acknowledgement, notification, and processing time. So our order total here came from the workflow itself, from that activity. That was a piece that we updated there. We've got some timestamps here coming from our WCF operations, and the rest are coming from port and orchestration milestones within our BizTalk components. So we've got data coming from three different technologies here. Specific to our workflow is that order total that got submitted in there by our interceptor configuration. For our third lesson, we'll focus on the WCF interceptor. We'll look at how to create the configuration specifically for WCF events, how to deploy those interceptors, and we'll look then at a demonstration of applying that to a service and seeing the data collected into our BAM activity fields. We'll finish up by touching on how you enable tracing for these interceptors so that you can get some diagnostic data if the interceptors aren't doing what you expect. The WCF interceptor plugs into the extensibility points in Windows Communication Foundation's channel level. So it allows us to configure all sorts of components that help us in processing messages as they arrive at a service or they go out through a client. This particular interceptor is what's known as a message and parameter inspector, which enables us to plug in both at the .NET object level before things are converted to a SOAP message, for example, or when it's been converted to a message and we want to process the message. Now in a request reply scenario, we can use the WCF interceptor to look at both inbound messages as well as response messages. And again, we can do this on the client or the service because WCF's model is compatible on both sides. The channel model allows that same extensibility on both sides. You can see here some of the specific WCF operations. So we have the ability to auto-generate a correlation token since we don't usually have a unique ID here like we would with a workflow or with an orchestration. We can get context properties. We'll see the various values that are available there in a moment. And then we can get information about the service endpoint, the endpoint itself, the operation being invoked, or something called the call point. And I'll talk more about that in a minute, but that helps us filter down where in the processing we want to intercept this message and process it. And then we also have an XPath operation that allows us to go into the message and pull out specific data, which is especially useful when we want to grab values for correlation or continuation, or we want to pull out specific values for updates. That WCF get context property provides us with a session ID and an event time. The event time is just a timestamp as to when this particular thing happened. The session ID is something provided by some components within Windows Communication Foundation, such as reliable sessions or a secure conversation or the security components. So if a session ID is present based on the WCF configuration, you would see it there. But if it's not, then that will return an empty value. So it may be something you could use as a unique identifier, but it's something you'd want to test and you want to ensure that your particular bindings on your WCF endpoints are going to support that. The get service contract call point is important, and it has to be a part of all of your filters when you're using the WCF interceptor. And the reason is that this really calls out where in that WCF extensibility pipeline you want to plug in to capture messages. The client side, and do we want to do the client request or reply, the client fault? Do we want to do the service reply or the requests here? So it's all about plugging into the appropriate messaging, the messages coming in or going out, whether they're the reply or the initial request, or whether they are the fault message going back, for example, where you might want to only capture data or information when there's a fault. As an example, you can see we have a filter here. We're going to use that get service contract call point. And we're going to indicate that this is a service request. So we're interested in messages coming into the service. And then we're also going to use the get operation name of process order. So if you're calling the process order method on your service, we're receiving the message on the other side, then this filter is going to match and we'll be able to then do updates or collect values from there. Now, just like the workflow system, you're also going to need to configure the WCF interceptor runtime. Now, WCF has its own extensibility points and it uses a model of behaviors. And so you need to add a behavior to your endpoint to enable this particular model where the message inspectors and the parameter inspectors get injected into the runtime. So you're going to be focused on specific endpoints. This allows you to apply your BAM tracking at a more granular level. You could also go in and add them across multiple endpoints if you wanted to. This is an example of a behavior configuration or just a configuration for WCF where we can see the extension called out. This tells WCF if you see a behavior called BAM Endpoint Behavior Extension, then you should be able to resolve that to this particular type. And then in the configuration file, we see under the endpoint behaviors, we've created a behavior and we've added in that BAM Endpoint Behavior Extension, providing that connection string and the polling interval seconds. This provides the same information or the same detail that we saw with the workflow interceptor, which is it gives the extension information about the primary import database. It can go look up its interceptor configuration from there. It knows where to write data. And it also knows how often to go back and pull for and find those changes that may have occurred to the interceptor configuration. Now we'll look at a demonstration. We'll see how to understand the interceptor configuration settings in a WCF interceptor config. We'll configure the BAM tracking for WCF. We'll also add that extension in, and then we'll test out that configuration to make sure everything's working. In this example, we'll take a look at the WCF interceptor configuration and collecting data from a WCF client. So I have an order client here. You can see that it has an order service reference. And if I view all files and we drill down into there, we'll see that we have a order service interface that is our service contract. That's going to be the contract that defines our interactions with this WCF service. So it's order client orders, order service. Now in my client application, what this is going to do is it's going to go out and create our proxy here, and then it's going to use an XML serializer, and it's going to deserialize a message from a file. It's going to take that XML and just turn it into a particular object now, and it's going to use this internal order that's also part of the service reference. So we have our proxy. We've now got the object that we can use. And we're going to, in a try block then, submit that order that we've created, that we've deserialized, through the proxy. So on our order service, we've got a particular operation here called submit order that we're calling from the client. If everything goes well, we'll just simply close everything down. Otherwise, we'll abort the proxy and close down a little more abruptly. Now, we have our WCF piece then. Let's look at our interceptor configuration. Oops, we've got our event source up here. We've given it a name of client proxy, indicated that it's a WCF technology. And now here you'll see that order service. Our service contract is the item that we specify in our manifest. So we're indicating that it's in the order client assembly, but it's that order service contract. Now if we take out our workflow event, we can see we have another event with a name of submit that we gave it, and the source is client proxy that's going to map back to our WCF manifest up here for the event source up here. Now here's our filter. The first item, of course, is going to be our get service contract call point, because this is required for all the WCF interceptor events. It's required to be in all the filters. And we're indicating that we want to have the contract call point equal client request. So we're interested in messages on the client proxy that are on their way out, that are making a request to a service. In addition, we're going to use the get operation name. And notice here we're using this WCF prefix. So we're using WCF specific interceptor configuration here, WCF specific operations. We want to get the operation name, and we want that to match submit order. So we're only looking for messages that are outbound and that are invoking this particular operation. So we add those two things together. Now, once we've isolated this down to an outbound message for that method, we can create a correlation ID. So here we use the WCF operation. We say we want to auto-generate a correlation token. So now we're generating that token, and we're going to pass that through. And then we come down here and we have an update. So when on the client, we call that operation, we want from the client application to update BAM. And we want to update when the order was received. We want to grab a context property now for WCF, and that's going to be the event time. Of course, we're doing a timestamp or a date time or business milestones. So we want to use that event time property to get the time that that operation happened. Now we also need to create a continuation token because we're at the client. We need to enable continuation to happen in our orchestration, which is going to receive this message. And so we need to create that continuation token. We use the operation constant here, and we put that together. And we're going to enable the continuation by drilling in with an XPath. So you can see here we've said WCF operation name equals XPath. We're going to go into the message itself, into internal order, and pull out the order ID. And then we'll concatenate those together. So we'll have WCF underscore and whatever the order ID is. Now, as we look at this NS0, that's got a map to some sort of namespace. Let's come up here to the top and you'll see that we can actually apply namespace mappings within that WCF configuration. So again, we're using the WCF interceptor config. We said that if you see that prefix, here's the URI that maps to. So what we're really looking for is, we go back down here, right, internal order, which is in that namespace that we've identified up there, and underneath that, the order ID. So the WCF piece should enable continuation, and it should also provide an update of the order received when we make that client call. Now the piece that's missing is, we've got our configuration, we've got our code, we need to hook in the runtime interceptor here for our client. So if we go to the order client and our app config, you can see that we've added in this behavior extension. We've added in the BAM endpoint behavior extension. So this isn't defined at the machine level. We've got to add it in here. And we've said I want to add in this BAM endpoint behavior. This is really telling WCF that if you see a behavior named BAM endpoint behavior extension, here's the type that that maps to. Here's the type you can go create for that to apply those settings and to have that behavior get added into the WCF runtime. So those are our extensions that we've called out. And now we have an actual endpoint behavior. This is how we go into a given client endpoint in WCF and apply certain behaviors. So we have a behavior named BAM endpoint behavior here, and we've used that BAM endpoint behavior extension name from up here. Now you will get the blue squiggly. The IntelliSense doesn't know about it, but it's okay because WCF knows about it. We just told it about it up above. And we're going to provide it those two key parameters, the connection string to the BAM primary database, so it can go look up that interceptor configuration, pull back the information about which operations it should actually be watching for and filtering for and what it should do. And then we'll give it the polling interval so it knows how often to go back to that BAM database and find any updates to the configuration. So all of this then is applied to our client endpoint right here. We have that same name now for the behavior configuration that points down to the configuration with the BAM endpoint behavior in there. That's going to hook all this together and enable then when we make calls for those inspectors, the message and parameter inspectors that the behavior injects, to inspect those messages and do our extractions, call the BAM APIs for us as we invoke those operations. So let's test this out. Let's go back to our billing application. I want to make sure this is running. So our billing application is up and running then. If we come back out, I'm going to submit an order, and that's going to start the process. That's going to send an order through BizTalk. And so if I go look at my reports now, I'm going to have one from a previous example where we looked at workflow, but I should have another one started here. You can see that so far the only things that have run are the order piece, the WCF piece, and the workflow piece. So in WCF, we've got that order received, and then we also have the billing was submitted over to the workflow, and so the workflow piece is run. We don't have any of the shipping pieces yet because we haven't done the shipping acknowledgement. So let's go submit our shipping acknowledgement. Come back in and wait a few seconds here. And then refresh. And now we can see, now that the shipping piece of the process is completed, we have the rest of the details there around how long the shipping took. So we've enabled the WCF configuration by using that behavior and plugging in that endpoint behavior, and by providing the interceptor configuration where we called out a specific operation and that service contract call point to filter down when those messages get applied or when those interceptors come into play. If you're having any problems with your tracing or things not working, you can use the system diagnostics tracing to debug that information to find out maybe what's going on there. So you can add in the source here, or the Microsoft BizTalk BAM interceptors. You could add in whatever kind of listener you want, depending on your host. So you could add in the console listener if you're hosting a service and a console app for testing. You could use the XML traced listener to write out to an XML file, or the event log listener. You decide. But the goal is that you can go in then and see what's happening at a lower level within the interceptors themselves. This will help you find out why particular filters aren't matching, for example, or why certain events aren't getting fired and updates aren't happening. Perhaps the data that's coming back at that time is null for some reason. So you can use this to help you troubleshoot your interceptors. In the lab, you'll have an example to deploy the initial BAM activity in its view. You'll create an interceptor configuration file, and then you'll deploy that file. Take the time to set up both the WF and WCF runtimes and test that out. So you get a chance to see the entire process of from deploying the BAM activity all the way through to using your interceptors and seeing the data collected up in the resulting BAM database table.